Tonight on Catalyst, we travel thousands of kilometres along the Darling and Murray Rivers. From the floodwaters in the north...
I'm walking beside the advancing flood front.
...to the fire-ravaged south.
The little-known relationship between fire and water.
We're knee-deep in acid mud.
Welcome to the billabong of the 21st century, where the water turns to battery acid.
From Queensland to South Australia, fire, flood and acid mud at the source of Australia's largest food bowl. Catalyst investigates the Murray-Darling Basin.
Hello, welcome to a special edition of Catalyst. It's no secret that Australia's greatest river catchment, the Murray-Darling Basin, is in crisis. Indeed, the system's running on empty. Now, different users are continually fighting for their share of the Murray-Darling's water. But remarkably, there is no way of accurately measuring how individual decisions about water use affect the catchment as a whole. So, scientists here at CSIRO in Canberra are hoping to change that. Deep in the heart of the Black Mountain Laboratory, researchers are working on what's been called the Sustainable Yield Project. This $11 million project is the most ambitious water inventory undertaken anywhere in the world. It factors in surface water and groundwater, plus the interaction between the two across 18 different regions. It also considers a number of different scenarios, such as an expansion of crops, forestry or dams, and changing climatic conditions.
To make all that happen, the scientists, of course, need a supercomputer.
1 million square kilometres of Murray-Darling Basin generates a lot of data. This machine can hold 60 terabytes, that's 75,000 CD-ROMs. Now, I'm going to tell you more about this project later, but first, we begin our journey in the Snowy Mountains, where Paul Willis reports on a major factor that will affect future water availability in the Murray.
The Snowy Mountains. Now, I know it's a cliche, but this really is a land of extremes. Bushfires 1 minute, ice and snow the next, and occasional showers in between. Yet it's this rain and snow that the Murray River depends on. Now, we've all heard about a number of problems with the quality and quantity of water in the whole Murray-Darling system. But the problem I'm about to explore starts before a single drop of water even gets into the river. And the source of that problem is completely unexpected. Believe it or not, bushfires are probably the most underestimated factor in the future of water supply, particularly up here in the high country. It seems that more bushfires equals less water downstream. Much less.
We're not talking about 1 gigalitre, we're talking tens of gigalitres or even hundreds of gigalitres when you look at the areas that are now being burned.
5 years ago, huge areas of the high country were burnt to a crisp in some of the most devastating bushfires we've ever seen here. What this means for water supply goes something like this. In a mature forest, when it rains, the trees and shrubs and grasses take what they need. The rest of the water trickles off to make streams and rivers or enters the groundwater. But when a bushfire comes along, the vegetation is suddenly and completely eradicated. For a year or two, water streams off at a great rate. But as the bush regrows, the burgeoning new vegetation literally sucks the water out of the ground. The result? Less runoff for the rivers. And this effect can last for decades. Professor Mark Adams at the University of New South Wales wants to put some serious data into the theory. So he and his colleagues are measuring every conceivable parameter that relates the growth of vegetation to fire and water. But how do you measure the way plants grow? You put a glass box around them and record the gases coming out. So what exactly do these boxes sample?
Yes, we take the sample of the gas and then it runs through these lines all the way back to the laboratory, and we measure the CO2, methane and N2O.
And how often does it... Oh, what's going on now?
Well, it's going to open because when we're not sampling, we want to keep the atmosphere the same as it is outside. So when we sample, they close. Most of the time, they sit open.
Dispersed throughout the nearby forests and grassy paddocks, groups of students measure things like water stress and leaf transpiration, as well as conducting infrared gas analysis and laser measurements of evaporation.
We're seeing the numbers that would indicate, say, a 20% loss in stream flow from an average subcatchment in the high country. Now, that can equate to a lot of water.
It's quite a shock to see just how much of the high country was burnt in that terrible summer of 2003.
And if you think it looks bad, it's about to get worse.
Back in Canberra, they're looking closely at bushfires. How often? Jeff Carey from the ANU is making some bushfire predictions.
We've built a landscape computer model, and this model here is for the ACT region. The warmer colours indicate shorter intervals between fires, so perhaps 10 to 30 years between fire events. The cooler colours, or the green colours, indicate much longer intervals between fires, perhaps as long as 80, 90 or 100 years between fires.
That's for the current climate. But what if Jeff factors in the sorts of temperature increases we might expect from global warming?
Rerun the model and we can look at the number of fires in the landscape that will occur under that changed climate. And the effect is quite dramatic.
Wow.
We're seeing a significant proportion of the landscape that's burning more frequently than every 10 years, indicated by this red colour. And if we link that with the rapid regeneration phase immediately after fire, that's certainly going to have implications for water use.
It looks like one of the biggest drains on the water supplies to the Murray-Darling is only going to get bigger. But unlike many other factors, there is something we can do about the burning high country and its effects on water supply. And that's with the highly controversial and emotionally charged practice of frequent controlled burns.
So if we can use fire to control fuels without creating mass regeneration, then we will suffer less, if you like. We won't lose as much water. Whereas if we let major fires run unchecked, where we have very high intensity fires over millions of hectares, then we create mass regeneration. And that will really move things to the upper limit of our estimates of the loss of water.
So bushfires may reduce the amount of water going into the Murray, yet the recent floods are having just the opposite effect on the Darling. Tom, there's a huge variety of factors you have to include in your modelling here.
That's right. That's why we built such a complete model of all those factors and how they affect the surface and groundwater resources across the whole of the Murray-Darling Basin. So when a flood happens, for instance, in Queensland, we can look at what happens to that water, the fate of it, as it works its way down through the system all the way to the Murray mouth, and visualise that through Google Earth.
Well, Jonica Newby's been tracking the flood pulse on the Queensland-New South Wales border, and it's bringing a rare explosion of life to the dusty outback.
It began in destruction. But as the torrent surged south, it slowed, spread, transformed itself from destroyer to creator. This is the lifeblood of our country's dry land river systems. This is the flood pulse. In a land where rivers are corseted and controlled, there's only one place you can see the flood pulse operating freely, as it has for millennia.
We're heading literally out the back of Bourke to the Paroo River system, the last untamed waterway in the Murray-Darling Basin.
My guide is Professor Richard Kingsford, the researcher who spearheaded the campaign to keep the Paroo wild, and who's done more than any other to uncover the intricacies of these spectacular, ephemeral floodplains.
Wow, look at that! That's incredible. How many birds are there?
Well, there's probably about 20,000.
20,000 birds.
20,000 pelicans, and you can just see them there.
It's hard to believe that just months ago, all this was desert. Our country's dryland rivers are not like other rivers. Lacking the seasonal input of snowfall or tropical rains, their flows are the most variable and unpredictable in the world.
It might happen once every 10 years, 20 years, but where in that 20 years? That's a mystery.
And that's what our wildlife are adapted to, a boom-bust cycle. And they spend most of their time in bust. So when the floods finally come, it's all on for young and old. Now I'm being taken deep into the heaving, breeding morass of Yantabulla Swamp.
So we've got egrets here.
Yeah.
And we've got spoonbills over there. And then there's a lot of darters over here. Yeah. And there are white-necked herons.
Underpinning all this fertility are these nutrient-rich microscopic arthropods that sat like seeds in the dry mud for a decade.
You just add water and everything just sort of erupts.
Many of these birds may get only one or two good opportunities to reproduce in their lives, and this brief window is it. There is another way Australia's dryland rivers differ from their northern hemisphere counterparts, and to get a sense of it, we're following the flood pulse once more downstream. This isn't just a river. It's a vast, braided floodplain network.
It's incredibly complex. It's probably maybe 20 to 30 kilometres wide here.
Sorry, you're saying the river's gone from 50 metres wide to 30 kilometres wide?
Yes, it's amazing.
And this is the Paroo's glittering jewel, Lake Pirie, a lake that weeks before was just dust. And it looks like we've at last reached the flood front.
This is really it?
Coming down, filling those cracks.
Oh, wow.
It's amazing, isn't it?
You can see it just inching forward.
This is so exciting. I love this part of it. This is the flood front.
Wow.
This is the beginning of the flood pulse.
Oh. I actually find it really moving that just behind me is land that's been hibernating for a decade, just waiting for this to give it the kiss of life.
But imagine if the flood pulse never came. Of the 20-odd major rivers in the Murray-Darling Basin, all but the Paroo are regulated by dams and weirs. These rivers no longer regularly break their banks. My final stop on this flood pulse tour is a visit to grazier Mark Etheridge. His nearby property sits right on the banks of the newly flowing Darling River.
So this is one of the trees that have died in the last few years.
Yeah, wow, that's completely had it, hasn't it?
It's not a drought thing, it's a lack of flooding.
And has that changed in the time that you've been on this property?
Yes, it's quite sad. Me and the kids used to camp under this tree some years ago before it died. You would never imagine this tree would die, but here it is, it's gone.
It's not just these centuries-old river redgums feeling the flood's loss. Even at the famous Macquarie Marshes wetland, bird numbers this year are just a fraction you'd expect of a rainfall this size. And it's a similar story for wildlife across the region.
The problem is that there's a limit to how long these microcrustaceans can live in their dried up stage as eggs. And once you lose that fundamental building block of the aquatic food web, you're just about gone. These floodplains are essentially left out of much of the decision making about water, and I think that is a fundamental problem.
With such iconic Australian landscapes at stake, many are now asking, can we release at least some of the flood pulse back into the basin?
These are the things that essentially define our landscape. You know, our rivers are burnt into our consciousness. And if we don't realise that this flood pulse is fundamental, we'll turn Australia into something that we can find anywhere else in the world.
So our river systems rely on a natural flood pulse to stay alive. But how much of that water needs to be shared with the environment in the future? That's another question the scientists here hope to answer. Mark Horstman takes up the story in the Riverina, right near where the Murray and Darling rivers meet.
On the surface, this looks like a healthy river. But appearances can be deceiving.
There's 13 locks like this along the Murray River across three states. They smooth out the highs and the lows of the natural flood pulse.
Keeping water levels permanently high was very useful for shipping, as it is now for irrigation. But the drought has exposed the river's dark underbelly.
A warning to you watching. This story contains images of the environment that you may find disturbing.
This is not some alien planet, but a lagoon just up the river from Mildura, called Bottle Bend. After 18 years studying the Murray, Darren Baldwin never expected to find a wetland as degraded as this.
I always keep on saying, if you're going to make a film about the end of the world, this would have to be on your shooting list. It's just dead.
The reason for this desolation lies in the chemistry of the mud, a type called acid sulfate soil.
Without my waders, my gloves and my safety glasses, then my skin would start to burn on contact.
And what we're measuring here is pH, which is on the bottom line there.
The value is under 2.
A healthy river has a pH no lower than 6.5, the ideal swimming pool around 7.2. This was once fresh water. Now it's sulfuric acid with a pH as low as 1.6. That's almost as strong as the acid in your car battery.
There's a million times more acid in the system because each pH unit is a factor of 10. So every time you go down a factor by one unit, you're actually increasing the concentration of acid by tenfold. There is a lot of heavy metals in this water because the acid has liberated them. So not only is it acidic, it's also rich in toxic metals like arsenic.
What's going on here starts with sludge full of sulfides made by bacteria. The sulfides combine with iron in the mud to make a mineral called pyrite. So far, all of this is perfectly natural. What's not natural is the locks and weirs that stop regular wetting and drying, so the pyrite mud builds up. While it stays waterlogged, the mud remains stable. The problem occurs when drought drops the water level. As the mud is exposed to air, the pyrites react with oxygen to make H2SO4, sulfuric acid.
These levels are absolutely extreme.
Keeping the nearby river artificially high behind the Mildura Weir doesn't help. It pushes salty groundwater full of sulfates into Bottle Bend. More salt and less water makes the problem worse.
This is business as usual. If you like, it's the price of agricultural productivity in this country, irrigation in particular. It's important for the country, but it comes at a price.
At the bottom of the Murray in South Australia, Hundreds of square kilometres of lakes are poised to go the same way.
Lake Albert is disappearing before our very eyes. Just a week ago, the edge of the water was 100 metres further up there. Now, as the water slips away, with each passing day, more and more of the mud turns into acid.
As the poison brews beneath their feet, Rob Fitzpatrick and his colleagues map the acid sulphate soils in the Lower Murray for the first time.
What is it?
Well, that's iron. It's an iron mineral we think is a mineral called schwepanite.
So the sulphides in here have oxidised to form this material.
Water extraction and drought have changed everything since they last sampled here less than a year ago.
The water here was a metre and a half, and where our feet are would be 20 centimetres below sea level. Yeah. And then below that we have thick, black, sulphidic soil sediments, black mud.
That's your acid mud.
The acid mud.
If the water in the mud drops a few more centimetres, the soils of the lake go beyond the point of no return.
We predict they would be acidic, but nothing like what we found. pH is well below pH 2.5, which is serious.
With 150,000 hectares already acid, the state government is pumping emergency water into Lake Albert to stop the mud drying out further. But there's a catch.
What's more of an issue is the metal release, particularly aluminium, that's very toxic to water supplies from these areas. When water comes back in or when it rains, that is a problem.
Searching for solutions, Rob's team follows the acid mud upstream to Murray Bridge, 1 hour's drive from Adelaide.
What we've got here is a wetland that's drained about 20 metres in that direction. We've got the Murray River right here, which is used for Adelaide's drinking water supply.
The challenge is to make sure any rescue attempt doesn't wash acid mud back into the river.
Create a wetland, that's the best and the most environmentally friendly way of doing things, but if you don't have water, another thing you can do is actually apply lime and mix it in so that you can neutralise the acidity.
If acid wetlands aren't contained like toxic waste dumps, Adelaide's water supply could be contaminated with arsenic.
If you were to drink the water that first touched this soil following rain, it could potentially be a lethal cocktail. Our research is focused on looking at what sort of metals and how much arsenic is going to be released from this material when the wetlands reflooded.
Beyond the Lower Murray, the crisis may be spreading further than we know.
Bottle ban may be an extreme case, but we know it's not unique. We surveyed about 81 wetlands throughout New South Wales, and of those, 20% at least of the ones we studied had the potential to turn out like bottle ban.
And at that rate, out of 30,000 wetlands in the Murray-Darling Basin, 6,000 could be turning acidic.
Well, here we are, the end of the line. This is where the Murray meets the ocean. We're about 100 kilometres southeast of Adelaide. And when you think about it, it's quite remarkable, really. Rain that fell on Queensland about 1,500 kilometres to the north ends up coming out here, as does the melting snow from the mountains. But that's the problem. These days, that water is just not getting here. In the past, the waterways at the end of the Murray, the Coorong Lagoon and several lakes, were full of life. Fresh water used to mix with the seawater here, creating a special environment where many different plant, fish and bird species could thrive. However, recent droughts and increasing irrigation upstream have taken their toll. Without human intervention by dredging, the Murray would no longer be flowing to the sea. The Coorong is being choked by extreme levels of salinity. If you want to get a feel for how little water is getting through to these parts, check this out. That's seawater from the ocean. On the other side of this barrage is fresh water. It's a lake fed by the Murray. Now, it used to be that the level in this lake was higher than the sea level on the other side. Now, the nearest freshwater is 4 kilometres that way. David Patton has been studying bird life here for more than 20 years.
Southern half used to be really good for a whole lot of fish-eating species like pelicans and terns, particularly fairy terns. Now the whole of the South Lagoon has none of those birds breeding in that system. And fairy terns in particular used to be around 1,500 in the 1980s and 1990s. It's now down to no more than 200. And that suggests that species is heading towards extinction.
And it's not just the bird life that's in trouble. The entire river system is failing.
We've seen the Coorong die. The cancer has now spread from the Coorong into the lake. The city of Adelaide is about to lose access to water and will then go up into the riverland. We're already finding irrigators further up the stream agonising that there's not enough water for them.
Professor Mike Young believes it's time for a realistic approach to how this finite resource is allocated.
We have an opportunity to fix the foundations on which the whole Murray-Darling Basin Agreement is right, to move from a system based on volumes to a system based on shares, where there's a share for all users and a share for the environment. If it gets drier, both sides have to get by with less water.
Science is learning more and more about what's wrong with our river system. And that information will no doubt influence how the $10 billion recently allocated by the Commonwealth Government to save the Murray-Darling will be spent. But however we decide to manage the water source for Australia's greatest food bowl and meet the needs of a thirsty and vulnerable environment, the fact is we'll have to learn to live with less water, not more. Next week on Catalyst, join me in the UK as I investigate how climate change is causing the spread of the dreaded blue tongue disease. Thanks for watching Catalyst. I'm Graham Phillips. See you next week.